Greetings and welcome to another edition of Berks Perspectives. I'm Chuck Gallagher, and with me today we have a full house. Aces, kings, and queens. On the aces side,
you're going to be sure about this designation.
I got something coming for you. Mary Ellen Mann, how
I'm
are
ace,
you?
I'm happy.
Aces. And we got a king, Fred Levering, and a queen.
Why, thank you.
And the Joker from Jekyll's Island.
Joker.
Via Jekyll's Island. Now we've got to deal with Mr. Hyde, or are we going to have the real Jekyll?
I'm not going there, Chuck.
Okay. I think before we begin the program, I'd like to send out a kudos to the Reading Eagle for having been named the third best newspaper in the state. Pittsburgh was first, New York second, the Eagle came in third, and that's super. We are appreciative of that. They give us a good source of information.
And three of their staff actually got first place in their specific categories. So congratulations to them.
They did well. I think, speaking of Berks County, the situation came out earlier this week that the president was going to be in Hamburg delivering his address. And for some reason, I don't know if that came out of Washington, if that came from his office, or if somebody misunderstood, when in fact it was Harrisburg that he went
to. They probably got confused. They sound similar.
They do?
It's an H and it's in Pennsylvania.
They both have an H and P.
Both H-bergs.
People in Hamburg are wondering
this
where.
This way you can tell Trump to go to H. And
they go to H wherever he goes.
They may have thought that Hamburg was the capital.
But where does he stay? Where does anyone stay in Hamburg?
Cabela's.
Where?
Well, that's what somebody said. There's no place, no building in Hamburg, PA, big enough to accommodate.
The field house.
The field house, good.
1,000 people.
Yeah, Fieldhouse could handle
it. I don't know why people said, oh, there's no appropriate place in Hamburg. Then somebody said, oh, it's Hamburg, New York. No. And then it turned out to be Harrisburg.
It was Harrisburg.
There'd also be my Aunt Pearl Jean's basement they could have used.
They didn't call?
No.
Oh,
no,
shoot. Didn't. Would she have charged them?
I don't know. She passed away last month.
Oh. Sympathies.
Again, in Berks County, we've got Birdsboro not wanting to accept the trash situation. The trash haulers want to dump in specific places, whereas the borough wants them to deal dump somewhere. Trash has been an ongoing problem in Berks County since, I don't know, at least 25 years. Pioneer Landfill, once upon a time, had been a nasty place. I think the Colebrookdale Landfill was purchased by Delaware County, I believe. And it's the one we have down on 176, New Morgan. So trash is an ongoing problem. We don't seem to be able to resolve it. The trash haulers want to dump where they are only going to be spending X number of dollars to dump, whereas the borough wants to.
The problem is that landfills have been ruled to be interstate commerce. So you can't stop a load from New York City or something coming to one of the landfills in Berks County. And that's what people object to. What Birdsboro was trying to do was to minimize the heavy truck traffic and keep their pickups going into Pioneer, which is next door, and they get a host fee of some kind,
right,
even though it's in Exeter, but they get some kind of a fee because of the impact in Birdsboro. And they're just trying to minimize how many trucks are coming and going and beating up the roads and stuff. So there is some rationale to it, but it was really kind of playing a hometown favorite.
Well, very much so. And they also were talking about raising the insurance, the required levels of insurance for any of the people that are picking up trash, and which doesn't sound like there's anything negative, but it sure sounds like they rushed both of those proposals through without a whole lot of discussion.
Well, I think sometimes they rush things through for the obvious reason. They won't get much attention, hoping. And ultimately, all these fees are going to pass on to the homeowner.
Well, you also have the refuse contracts usually come up at the end of the year, so they were probably just trying to get it in before the end of the year.
You're giving the benefit of that. You are in a good mood today.
I'm a municipal government
guy.
You're
glowing. Yes, I know you're a municipal government guy. And speaking of that, Ole Township and Ole Borough has taken upon a new police focus. They've joined forces with Central Berks.
They had their own with just a couple of guys. I guess they were mainly part-time with one chief full-time or something, and they weren't able to then have 24-hour coverage without relying on the state police, which is somewhat problematic, and not because the state police don't do a good job, it's just because there's a limited number of them
and geography
overnight, and therefore may not get coverage for some number of hours. So they're joining a regional force, which is a very smart move. I think.
Joining the original, I think the cost is basically about the same, what they were paying, what they're going to have to pay.
I believe it's
pretty Central close. Berks is pretty close, $600,000 and change. Mm-hmm. Also, the mayor of Reading has come out and said that he's not in favor of legalizing marijuana or actually bringing down the charges for small amounts of marijuana. City Council voted, I believe, 4-2 in favor of asking the legislature to go along with that, but the mayor found it just to be a little, he finds it, I guess he considers it more of a gateway drug than most people have come around to consider.
But the key thing is what you said, that they were recommending to the state legislature to do something about it. They weren't legislating that it would now be legal in the city of Reading.
And it was that point that made it difficult for me to understand.
So yeah. I think he sort of overreacted.
Stopping out of the meeting was not the best. I mean, it wasn't attempting to change the way our police handle the situation or anything. I think that that was a legitimate way of asking the state legislature to consider it. And then
I think he may have fallen back to his years as a district justice when he dealt with all these cases day in and day out.
But I mean, and I think it had to do with less than an ounce of marijuana, right? When you think about the number of people who are incarcerated, whose lives are ruined because we have these tough on crime laws, and the amount that it's costing taxpayers, those prisoners inevitably come out worse than they went in, and I think it makes a lot of sense to reconsider.
Well, there was, I guess, some pushback about what the cost would be, because there was a claim that if they changed the designation of, you know, it wouldn't be a misdemeanor. I forget the other term they used, it began with an S.
Summary.
That the only difference between those two and the Pennsylvania law is one entitles you, the misdemeanor entitles you to a trial by your peers. And the summary, the judge can make the decision.
Right.
So you don't have to go through the expense. So people had pushed back saying this would not reduce expense. I don't know how it could not. All right. And I think his concern was, you know, people would be getting off relatively scot-free for doing something that's considered illegal. It's still illegal. It's just the degree of, you know, the punishment that you would have.
Plus your record.
Mm-hmm.
You get the summary offense. It's not going to go on your record.
I think everybody focused on the fact that he stormed out of the room. I think what was equally wrong was the council then turning around and saying, how do you go punish him and say, let's go censor him? And I think that was wrong that Donna Reed did. But...
Well, I think storming out of the council chambers is something I would really like to have seen, because he had his administration
online.
Went with him, though. You know,
videos online if you'd like to go see it.
Okay.
Yes,
all right. I'll have to look it up. Speaking of taking things out, it seems that our president and our Environmental Protection Agency and our Education Secretary all seem to want to take things out that have been passed and set up by the Obama administration. This is kind of a new broom is definitely sweeping clean. And we can start with...
Well, I have a slightly biased view since I have a master's degree in Community Parks and Recreation Service, so I kind of like the National Park Service, and I used to like the Department of Interior, but it's pretty ironic that you've got somebody who's supposed to be responsible for the interior of this nation now saying we're going to reduce the number of monuments, we want the ability to take back designation on things like national parks, we're going to open up the lands for further, you know, fossil fuel harvesting, and we're going to use our private jet and burn up those fossil fuels for unauthorized charter utilization. I'm not exactly a fan of the head of the Department of Interior right now.
And you also mentioned UNESCO, was it?
Oh, yeah. He, 45, has also decided that we no longer need to be a member of UNESCO, which when you think about it, I don't know about anybody else on the panel here, but I love traveling to some of the World Heritage Sites. And it has become politicized in the last few years. It's been politicized for many, many years. Apparently, Reagan pulled us out of UNESCO while he was in office. We subsequently got back in. We also, I guess, stepped out in the 1940s, shortly after it was created, and then we went back. But when you think about what the mission of UNESCO is, it's to foster education and learning, scientific exploration, sharing after World War II. That's why UNESCO was created. And I think it's another one of those plays by 45 to say we're paying for more than our share of it. We're paying for about 20-something percent of it, and we shouldn't be paying that much. So everybody else pony up or we're gone. So we're in until the end of 2018.
Well, he also took Penn to eliminate the, what was it, the air control factor, the clean air
power
control.
Plants. Clean
health. I think it's a 38-page document that does not once mention the term climate control.
Well.
Or climate change, rather.
That's a whole other thing. That's another topic, too, that we can
take
a look at.
Well, it's not.
But the intent of the clean air regulations was to basically clobber the coal industry. And
actually,
no, the intent was to clean. It was to clean the air.
The protections to clean the air are already in place. This was just another layer to make life difficult for the coal industry.
It was to reduce CO2 emissions. Right? And
it would have had some incredibly tiny impact on CO2 over the long haul.
Now hear this. Coal is not coming back. I don't care what the president does or promised. It is simply not coming back. It is now cheaper to use natural gas, which is in plentiful supply. He is throwing red meat at his diminishing base. And
selling fairy tales.
He is. Yeah.
Well, natural gas is not necessarily an all fairy tale either. I mean, you're taking a very difficult possibility with all these pipelines going on, and a lot of people are upset about that.
I understand that, but it's just not going to happen.
I think the three of us understand that fossil fuel is not the future. And if you hang your hat and the future of this country on fossil fuels, then you're shooting yourself in the foot.
And the rest of the world's going to pass us by.
You bet.
Yeah.
And they're going to perfect all these things and utilize all these things. And we're going to be sitting here still trying to, in my idea, subvert ANWR and dig in the Arctic wildlife for oil and gas when it's not necessary. It's absolutely unnecessary to do these things and ravage the earth when Mother Nature has given us these amazing ways that are free, pretty much, and there all the time. And we don't have to ruin stuff.
Can I talk to you about purchasing the Penn Street Bridge from me? I mean,
that's insane.
Can I talk to you about restoring blacksmithing as a profession?
I think your next car will be a Ford.
The commercial use of solar and wind to meet the energy needs of this country are a fantasy.
Why is it happening all over Europe? And they are absolutely as progressive as we in terms of their needs.
There's certainly nothing wrong with developing those technologies, but they are not sufficient at this time.
Well, they're only not sufficient at this time because nobody has taken
example. To shut down all the coal-fired plants and replace them with gas requires a gazillion dollars that somebody's going to have to spend.
But Fred,
I mean, we're losing sight of economic reality
is economic reality now more important than lifestyles 50 years from now?
It has to transition. You just can't throw a switch, which is basically what Trump is doing, is rolling back executive actions that were made without consulting Congress and stuff, and saying, let's figure it out over the long haul instead of trying to force this to happen immediately.
You know, I will partially agree with you. What he's doing is getting rid of regulations that were put in place that have very little, in many cases, actual consequences, because the coal industry is already diminished. So to basically say the coal industry can go do whatever they want probably isn't going to go have much of an impact, because there's not much of a coal industry left. If he was a true leader of this country and of the world, what he would be doing is not saying, coal industry, go knock yourself out and go pollute. He'd be saying, what are the alternative sources of energy that we as Americans need to invest in to ensure the future of the country as well? Not just pay me now and skip about pay me later. Just, you know, that's the power of what can I get money from today, or how do I get my base rallied up behind me, as opposed to what investments do I put in for the future. That is much harder, and he has been totally ineffective at trying to do that.
Setting the stage for future investments is a wonderful idea. The bottom line is that economically they don't serve the nation's needs at this point.
But economically, coal is not, it is becoming less and less viable. And when you look at what it does, I mean, particularly now, they've also allowed they've allowed waterways to be polluted by the mining, because he's undone that restriction.
and you look at the pulmonary issues related both to the miners and to the people who live within the range of the coal-fired plants, and the health, how much are we spending to care for those people, and the health issues related to asthma.
Are we?
Yeah, or we may not be. But I mean, you know, that's all a part of the fix. It isn't just bottom line, what's it cost to produce a kilowatt of electricity.
And even if it
was,
though?
It is far bigger than that.
Even if it was, there is a very basic solution that people could go look at right now and invest in this company, in this country, if we wanted to. Think of all the buildings that exist in this country. All right? How many of them have rooftops that have direct exposure to the sun throughout the day? If there were programs that were built in such as some of the states that had subsidization of solar programs, that we could go harvest that energy today, we could be producing all we needed for America in a matter of just a couple years if solar cells and the implementation of those cells was made affordable, which is why there are people like, who's the guy that invented?
Tesla.
The Tesla, yeah.
Tesla.
Okay. He owns the largest, I forget the name, Solar City. He owns that company.
Right.
And they're going out and basically putting systems on people's houses and essentially renting them back to them, charging them the same fee that they're being paid, that they would pay their electrical company. They're using individual homeowners to build their own infrastructure, which, you know, is a great concept in capitalistic America, but people should be doing that would be the government.
Didn't he offer to do the same thing in Puerto Rico? He said they could build enough solar
because
plants in Puerto Rico to bring that island back to...
Tesla has taken it a step further, and they've actually devised solar shingles. So that when you put on one of these roofs, it's not cheap. It will come down in cost eventually. But when you put these shingles on your roof, it becomes a solar panel.
But a home's roof, assuming the sun's out, it's not cloudy, could be a good source of energy for that home. The square footage on the rooftop of a city high-rise isn't going to come within putting a dent in the energy needs of that building that's below it. That's just...
But if my house produces more than I need, the utility or whomever is going to be behind the scenes for collecting that that energy can go use some of what's on my house. It's not going to solve the problems of the world.
And you do understand that all of this fossil fuel is finite, Fred. You got that, right? So if it's finite, don't we owe it to ourselves, our children, our grandchildren, whoever is coming behind us, to at least look at ways to become less dependent?
You need to define finite. It's not finite in the sense that we're going to run out of natural gas next week. It's going to be hundreds of years. So in the meantime, let's work on perfecting these other things and making them economically viable.
But we don't.
But to try to shut down the coal industry right now, which is essentially what President Obama attempted to do, is wrong.
Well, speaking of withdrawals, what's the consensus here on pulling out of the agreement with Iran? That's another step away.
It seems as though everybody...
It's the worst deal we could have possibly ever gotten into.
Well, since McMaster just told the Senate that he thinks that it's something we should remain in that agreement, I don't see...
But to borrow your phrase, 45 wants to do it.
If it was something that Obama was associated with,
he wants to repeal it.
Well, the Europeans have made it clear that it's staying in place. And if the United States pulls out, they're alienating themselves. Yeah.
But
what does it say when a nation signs an agreement, an international agreement, and then pulls out? How can they be trusted?
They can't.
They can't until the next
never really was signed. It didn't go through the Senate as it should have, as all treaties are supposed to. It never did that. So what you have here is a situation where there's a difference between pulling out of the whole thing and not recertifying it. By not recertifying it, he's acknowledging
it to Congress.
We acknowledge that there's other people that need to weigh in, and that the Iranians are clearly in violation of some of it already.
It isn't clear.
Some of the acts.
It isn't clear.
It is
supporting terrorism.
But that's not. But that's not part of what this is.
Supplying stuff to North Korea.
But you're mixing apples and oranges.
It is a limited treaty.
Only
and it has
to
do
with
the development of nuclear.
It doesn't and it has been said over and over and over again by other than Republicans that there should be ways to take Iran to task for some of the what they're doing in order to support extremism. But that's not what 45 is talking about. And for you purposefully to mix apples and oranges in this conversation doesn't seem right either.
No, I'm saying it needs to go back to Congress where it belonged, and then some of those things can be negotiated.
Let me throw a tangerine into the discussion.
Make it a grapefruit.
A grapefruit, okay. The bump stop apparatus, which enables a semi-automatic weapon to fire, though a full automatic weapon, looks like it might have a shot of being passed. However, Mr. Ryan has said, well, we have to take a look at this and there are things to be adjusted for it and all that.
I'm glad to hear bipartisan agreement in that direction, at least.
Well, is this real or is this
it's a sop.
Just a sop?
It's a sop, that's
making.
All it is.
But it's sad.
Now, this is what occurred as a result of the tragedy in Las Vegas.
So automatic weapons are illegal in the United States. We have a device that can turn a semi-automatic into an automatic weapon.
Right.
That should be illegal.
I don't understand. Well, I mean, that's all you really need to know. That product should not be allowed to be sold.
But it's a product of and by itself that has nothing to do with guns.
Well, I mean,
the
fine line is that, the definition of an automatic weapon is that you pull the trigger once. With a bump stop, the trigger gets pulled a bunch of times mechanically. And so that's the very fine line which says that it's not in violation, but I think that's just nuts.
What else would it be used for other than to turn a semi-automatic into an automatic weapon?
Yeah. Well, of course, that's why it was invented, I'm sure, but does this open up the door for any more gun control?
No.
Or is this just, as you say, a sop? And do we need gun control?
We absolutely do. My God.
Well, we do have plenty.
We have far more people dying in this country than anywhere else in the world by guns. And I was sharing some statistics before the program started. We have 5% of the world's population, and we own 50% of the world's civilian guns. Now, tell me there's not a direct correlation between that and mass shootings. I mean, there are mass shootings every month in this country, and they're not happening in Canada, they're not happening in France, they're not happening in Germany.
Australia.
But when it happened in Australia, they implemented really, really tough laws, and they haven't had a mass shooting since. The same in Norway, where that, I think it was either Norway or Sweden.
Norway.
Where the one,
campground shooting.
Yes, right. And he murdered all kinds of people in two different places. But they responded with legislation that makes it far more difficult to own.
Okay, we're going to go beyond.
That kind of weapon.
Well, and to say this is not the time to talk about it is just ludicrous.
Manure.
It is just ludicrous.
Well, that's the whole idea. We've gotten to the point where we're just saying now, tragedy, we have to pray for it and give our send out our sympathy. And
that does precious little for the lives that have been lost.
Or the mothers and fathers. We talked about this last week. You know, how many thoughts and, excuse me, it's not helping anybody.
Well, the idea is a nice idea, but that's it, basically.
I'm not sure. I think let's enact some legislation that really makes a difference.
I think it's lost any kind of feeling that it might have had in the beginning. But after Aurora, after Columbine, after Sandy Hook, after this one, it becomes rote.
We have become numb to it, yes. And the new normal is that it's okay to kill each other.
My comment to somebody, I got involved in a Facebook argument, and my comment with somebody who said, we need to pray for these people, that you're in my thoughts, and that they're in our thoughts, et cetera. I said, you know what? You want to pray? Go ahead and pray. Pray that you get the courage to pick up the phone and call your legislators. Pray that you have the fortitude to go into the ballot box go into the voting booth on election day and vote in people that are willing to go help.
That are willing to stand up to the gun industry. And it has nothing to do with the Second Amendment. It only has to do with profits, yeah.
The NFL flags.
Boy, you're full of wonderful opportunities for discussion.
Okay, I'll keep you guys rolling. But right now, what has happened? We had the vice president go to a football game on Sunday.
Spent $250,000 to walk out of a game.
Well, he didn't spend it.
Well, spent $250,000 to walk out of a game.
But he went there, and a minute, a couple of the 49ers knelt down. That was it. Out we go. That was all pre-planned.
I'm sure it was.
But at the same time, when they marched, the Nazis marched in Charlottesville also this past weekend, there wasn't much of a hue and cry, and nobody was there to walk out.
You know, it's funny. I happened to be shopping yesterday, and there was two kids in a shopping cart playing with a toy, and it was a patriotic toy that played the Star Spangled Banner. And I found it absolutely fascinating that as I looked around the store, and there, I must have been able to see 30 people that were within earshot of that toy, no one stopped what they were doing. No one stood at attention with their hand over their hat, their heart, or took their hat off. Every single person just kept looking for bargains, okay? We are a bunch of hypocrites in this country. We have a president of this country who has turned a discussion on racial injustice into an issue about the flag. Again, only to get his base, you know, riled up, okay?
And a draft dodger to boot.
And we have a president who is now continually threatening the First Amendment, all right, and imposing his will on when it is acceptable and where it is acceptable to express your opinion, while he is doing so from the bully pulpit and on Twitter on a daily basis. Don't tell me how to protest. Don't tell me when to protest, all right? Or my view is, you know, I'll start thinking about things like, you know, I think it's immoral to waste my money on fill in the blank that the government spent. So you know what? I'm going to protest. I'm not going to pay my taxes. Or, you know, whatever. I mean, we're allowing people to make more, based on their own morals, what we do and do not do in this country. We saw it again today with the changes in the Affordable Care Act. Okay, we've seen it in the past week with the removal of the need for the Affordable Care Act participants to provide coverage for women's health, okay, with abortion, okay?
Hey, Chip, Chip's gone.
Or birth control.
Just birth control is the primary thing.
I commented on Facebook, too. I wonder if Steve King, the representative from Iowa, I think he is, understands that by denying women birth control and access to abortion, he's going to increase the number of children of non-whites who he is so suspicious of. And made, do you remember his comments about, you know, he's not really interested in raising
their kids? More food stamps will be going out, more welfare will be going out?
Is that
where you're going with that?
Yeah, well, people of color aren't the kind of people that he respects and believes should be in this country.
I think every woman in America who has sex with men
should stop.
Should just say, I'm sorry, we'll no longer have sex with you until I get my women's rights back, okay? And I think every time that we have a mass shooting, I think we're going to stop and take a look at who's doing it, because I can't wait for 45 to start the same kind of campaign against, you know, racial inequality and ISIS as he does to all of the white males who have perpetrated the vast majority of the gun shootings in America. I'm just trying to be ironic.
But they're always lone wolves. The white males are always lone wolves. The others are always a part of a Muslim cult or because they're black.
This is an unprepared segue into Harvey Weinstein.
Another
power play discussion.
Yes.
Oh, golly, what a disgusting figure.
But here is a man who has done some wonderful, wonderful work in terms of the films that he's produced and he's been involved with. Yet there is a dark side. Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde.
Don't point to me.
Nope.
I gave you that at the beginning.
So you're supposed to come back with that famous, thou shalt not commit adultery. Yeah.
The fact that this is just tolerated or people look the other way.
Bill, what's his name?
It's
Bill?
A part of the objectification of women, which seems to have a resurgence at this point.
And what was his justification? I came of age in the 60s and 70s when things were different and this was acceptable, right? So you've got that whole mass of people in America that think that it's perfectly acceptable, you know, which goes back to why
the locker room stuff that was a part of the tapes from Trump during the election campaign.
And locker room talk.
Yeah, it's just locker room. It's what boys say to each other.
But it's Bill O'Reilly, it's Roger Ailes, it's this dude. And I would think that those guys are at the very tip of a large iceberg.
Oh, one congressman in Pennsylvania.
This is the great conspiracy of white males. I just want to point out everybody you just named were the white males. So I can't wait for 45 to go after them.
Okay, after white males?
Oh, yeah, I'm being a smart aleck.
I would hope so.
Isn't there just a touch of hypocrisy here, though, that when that other laundry list you just rattled off got caught, that there was this tremendous outrage? This guy's been getting away with this stuff for decades.
Well, there's plenty of outrage,
friends
though.
In Hollywood all kept their mouths shut.
Sure,
isn't
because
that,
he had the power.
Ironic? Had
the power. Oh, no, I think it's exactly the same. Well, it's happened
same
for
with,
decades on
with Bill
with
O'Reilly.
Fox News.
And they kept their and those conservatives kept their mouths shut,
Fred. I think it just shows the mindset of a lot of the media in this country is just, oh, he's one of our guys, so you look the other way.
I think this is like the flag versus racial inequality issue again. We're now saying, okay, we're going to treat this differently based upon what party you're affiliated with. The treatment of women as objects is wrong regardless of who does it, when they do it, or where they do it, and regardless of their political stance.
Agreed.
Period.
Yeah, I agree.
And it should not be tolerated by anybody.
They kept their mouths shut for decades on this guy.
I cannot speak for what somebody else has done,
but it's
across...
You're making it sound as though Bill O'Reilly did it for 6 months.
In most of these cases, they were not new.
Jesus. You know.
And basically the point is that women, for whatever reason, each individual has kept their mouth shut, either embarrassment or fear.
Or they were paid off.
And think about some of the people that kept their mouth shut, okay?
Gwyneth
Angelina Jolie is not somebody who I would ever think would be, you know, a wilting rose. I mean, these are some very powerful people in Hollywood.
Gwyneth Paltrow, yeah.
But I don't think they were powerful when it happened. But I don't think they were powerful when it happened.
Right.
It's way easier for any man to make somebody who's young and inexperienced and not already successful in the industry, it's easier to bend them to your will just by the force of your personality.
Well, and I think just to be fair, it is unfair for anyone to treat anyone else as an object, regardless of gender as well.
Well, and somebody, well, I don't want to, anyhow.
There's a Dylan Thomas poem that goes, "When the fire in my loins was a hunter," which goes to that 50s, 60s thing, that whole idea. And I'm not going to make this a segue, but I do think we should talk a little bit about the fires in North Carolina.
North Carolina.
I don't know where Carolina came from. But California, that is such a devastation. It's just incredible.
Well, and I heard somebody say today that maybe it was in the late 50s, there were much larger fires than this, but that whole area, in that same area, but it hadn't been developed. You know, and so they're building homes in areas that are tinderboxes, essentially.
Yeah. Something like Houston building homes in the floodplain.
Floodplains.
It was just mind-boggling to me to watch, like, a lot of the before and after. My sister recently moved, but she lived in Santa Rosa. So to see some of the wineries that had been there, and she works in the wine industry. So to be familiar with some of those places and then just see them as smoldering messes. There's also a haunting, haunting video online these days about the United States Postal Service delivering mail to that neighborhood, Coffey, I think is the name of that town, where that development, totally burned out homes, and the United States Postal Service is delivering mail. It's just otherworldly.
Yes, very much so, indeed. I think I also want to take some time off to take a look basically at Mr. Trump and Senator Corker. There's a corker. How are we doing, guys?
I find it very offensive that we have been reduced to the senator and the president slugging it out on Twitter. Why don't they pick up the damn phone and talk to each other? I mean, this is ridiculous.
Or better still, face to face.
Yeah. I mean, it's just
As one who has
awful.
Never tweeted, I absolutely
agree. I mean, why... I'm sorry, I confess. I mean, it does. You think that it could be handled so much better if they were just talking it out or duking it out or whatever needs to be done.
But, adults would do that. Speaking of adults, I think we'd probably run a little bit over our time. I think it's time for us to say so long. Thanks for joining us. Now, next week we're going to be off because BCTV is having its great fundraiser, that auction. If you want to tune in all of next week for some wonderful things that you can bid on and help BCTV stay with us. And we hope to see you again here in 2 weeks. Be well. We'll be right back.